Welcome to School Talk. I'm Nadja Varney, your host. As technology and communication seems to be dissolving barriers between countries, American colleges and universities are building global campuses. Today, my guest is somebody who's on the cutting edge of international education. Dr. Beverly Shaklee is the director of the Center for International Education, and she's a professor of curriculum and instruction at George Mason University. She's a researcher, author, and an initiator of new international educational programs. Welcome, Dr. Shaklee.
Thank you.
I am so delighted that you took time, because I know this summer, in fact, when I was talking to you earlier, you had, I think it was 150 teachers coming on campus for something connected to your center. Mm-hmm. So I'm so grateful that you would come today. But how did you get interested in international education?
I think it's been an evolutionary process. Over time, I've always been interested in teachers, and I've kind of followed the track of teachers through elementary education, and then gifted education, and then finally into the international arena, because I think they're so vitally important to what happens with children and families in our communities. So it occurred over time. I was very fortunate to have great mentors at my former university. And my dean came down the hall one day and she said, I have a ticket to go to Russia to talk about preparing teachers for a democratic society. Would you like to go?
Wow.
And I said, of course, I'll go. And that probably was my first real immersion in international education per se, but still focusing on teachers and teacher education.
Isn't that, I think the word I used at the opening was very appropriate, initiator. You are willing to jump in where others might fear to tread. That's wonderful. I wonder, you know, I want to know what's driving this ever-growing interest in global education, and I wonder if it could be a consequence of this idea that's out there now that technology and business have really dissolved all the barriers between nations. And it's a concept which I think it was Thomas Friedman who mm-hmm. wrote, The World is Flat. And because in the past, we had students who would go off to another country very briefly just to, you know, get a mm-hmm. taste of culture.
Sure.
But it seems to me that international education now has a much broader meaning to it and a much broader reach. So my question is, what is driving this, its ever-growing interest and a commitment to international education?
I think there's several things that drive it. Certainly the mobility of families now. You mentioned business, you mentioned blurring the lines with technology and things like that. But it's also, we have highly mobile families now. It's not unusual for children to be traveling with their parents all over the world and then coming back into U.S.-based schools. That would be one area. A second is simply the demographics of our current population and how they are changing. It's estimated by some scholars that by 2010, one out of three children will be from immigrant families in our public schools today. So those children are bringing, and those families are bringing with them their heritage, their culture, their language, their traditions. And in order for us to be better prepared as domestic teachers, we need to know more about international. One of the ways we do that is by having the opportunity to travel abroad, but then to really become immersed mm-hmm. and really live in a country as part of the country. And that changes perspective and changes views. So I think there are a variety of elements kind of all coalescing together at the same point in time to say that it needs to be more than just a travel abroad program. It needs to be more systemic and more sustained mm-hmm. and an embedded part of our curriculum.
I can see how the emphasis has changed, and probably, as you say, just what's happening in this country mm-hmm. in terms of immigration. I grew up in New York City
yeah.
and in Manhattan. So we were a very, you know, a melting pot back then, but now it seems to be across the whole country.
Well, it is, and for instance, one of the elementary schools that I work in that's local, at last count, when you walked in the hallway, they had flags from 37 different countries. And they had, I believe it was somewhere along the lines of 109 languages and dialects spoken in the building. We are international. We may not use the word, but we are yeah. international.
And you're so close here in Virginia to Washington, D.C., at mm-hmm. least right here in Fairfax. I think that may be the school you're talking about.
Right.
But actually, in Massachusetts, in a small city of Attleboro where I was, there were 60 languages
sure.
at that point. So it's really across the board. In our market economy, which I sometimes worry about, I think it was Dr. West who said that it's kind of gone crazy, or I think he called it capitalism gone wild or something like that. So I worry about that. But their main goal, their obvious goal, is the bottom line and profit.
Sure.
What are the really overarching goals, the broad purposes that higher education has in getting so involved? What are those overarching and broad purposes for international education?
I would say that, although you are correct that part of it probably is market-driven, not all of it by any means. There are goals that a university holds, and particularly our college, as a good example, of adopting values that lend themselves to international education, values such as working towards social justice, values such as inquiry orientation, values such as compassion for others. And those things are exemplified by a university when they not only reach out to having international students here to broaden our own perspective, but also work abroad in developing nations or countries that want to change their teacher education programs. And so I think that the bigger commitment is being a citizen of the world and making a positive contribution in whatever way you've got the expertise to do so. Mm-hmm. So I think that that's really a larger driving force.
It sounds like to make the world a better place.
Very much
really.
So.
Really, yes, mm-hmm. that's grand mm-hmm. to hear in today's mm-hmm. world where every 3 minutes is it on TV, you're being sold something. I think we're raising consumers. So it's so good to hear this kind of a wonderful purpose. And you say we are international. So is it important, do you think, for all American students now to think of themselves as global citizens?
I do. I think it's very important that they see themselves as being responsible not only to their peers and to the future, but that they see themselves as being responsible to the world and to the planet. I know that sounds like a really big job for any child to take on, but I think that there's an orientation or a disposition that says we are all in this together. We're all here together. And I should have compassion for those who have less than I have. I should have a responsibility to be able to figure out a way to give back no matter who I am. And international schools that adopt an international curriculum oftentimes adopt those kinds of principles in terms of what they do, but they don't stop with the principles. They work on the theory of action. So that if I work with a child and they are working toward solving a problem, then it's not just solve the problem, what action do I help them take to make it authentic or to make it real? So we have high schools that are involved in the Global Issues Network around the world, and they take on varying kinds of problems and projects both within their own community and then contributing to other communities, building homes in Africa. And these are high school students who do that. So colleges also have that kind of a responsibility as well about how do we engender those kinds of world citizens.
Mm-hmm. Now, how about the younger children when we think about kindergarten? And I know you've taught in many mm-hmm. of the grades before you came into higher education. How do we foster that kind of global idea in small children who, you know, they're just learning that they're part of a town or
right,
a city.
Right, exactly.
You know, those early about our city bulletin boards.
Sure, sure.
So how do we foster this kind of international global citizenship in small children?
You start with age-appropriate activities, just as you mentioned. You do, what can I do locally? You know, they'll do a study of their playground, and is it ecologically sound? And use appropriate words for them, but then they can come up with a anti-littering program for their school or whatever the small pieces are. Demonstrating caring for another person is something that's very much a part of early childhood education. And then helping children understand what does it mean to care for another person. So you don't take them out on the world map, per se, but you do take them within their world and then expand it as they grow older.
I think that's the clue, is expanding it as they go along. And you work with teachers so much that must be part of your job mm-hmm. of bringing them to the next, helping them to bring the children to the next step. I read about a phrase called international mindedness.
Yes.
What's the role of language in this? I don't know. Are schools now emphasizing learning a second language? Hablo español un poquito. I speak Spanish very little, but that was from learning it in high school and meeting people after it. So what is the role of language in this international mindedness that you read about?
Many people would say it's a requirement. If you're associated with the International Baccalaureate Organization and IB schools, which are some of the fastest growing schools domestically, as well as the 2,000 some they have around the world, a second language is required of children from entry into school clear through graduation, sometimes a third. Domestically, it varies by district. There are a lot of good school districts in the United States, as you know, that emphasize multilingual, multi-language classes. We have some that are full immersion schools where they do half a day in German and half a day in English. We have an oncoming population of teachers to teach Chinese. So it's very dependent on the school district, the local board, and the local community about its importance. I personally think it's very important.
Mm-hmm.
For teachers as well as students.
Teachers as well. Yes, I enjoy languages, and I've run into quite a few people who read a second language, mm-hmm. but really don't speak and communicate. And that's an interesting twist in languages as well. But to move beyond that, other things you do in your center,
sure.
The Center for International Education here at George Mason University, it's very unique. It doesn't directly offer like an academic program as I understand it. So maybe you could just tell us what is the mission of the Center for International Education, and then maybe start to describe some of your activities.
Sure. We're relatively young. Although the George Mason faculty have done international work since the university was started, we didn't have a home. And so 3 years ago, we were chartered as a center to kind of be an umbrella for all of the international experiences and teaching and workshops and research the faculty were doing. First it let us get to know one another. You could be in country and just find out that somebody else was there and you didn't know they were there and you didn't know they were working. So we needed to network internally, and that was an important part of what we wanted to do. The three main parts of what we do, one is research and development. We work with a variety of research grants, primarily in teacher education, mm-hmm. primarily to help either developing nations or nations that are at a point of retooling teacher education. And for instance, we are bringing in this week 26 teachers from Eurasia, from higher education. They are teachers of English. They'll spend 6 weeks with us, and they will do pedagogy, they will do technology, and they will do some other leadership action research kinds of activities with us for those 6 weeks. And that's funded under the International Research Exchange Commission. That would be an example of the kind of research and development work that we do. The academic programs we have, and we may speak a little bit more about them later, mm-hmm. would be under the rubric of Fast Train. And those are teacher preparation programs for teachers who want to specifically teach abroad. And then the third thing we do is kind of a professional development piece. Schools may contact us internationally and ask for expertise in working with special needs children. So we've had faculty who've worked at the American School in Paris over several years to help them look at working with special needs children and upgrade the teaching skills in terms of doing that. So it's a variety. We wear a lot of hats. We do a lot of different kinds of things, but it also keeps it very interesting.
Wonderful. Well, we're going to take a break. But when we come back, I'm going to ask for some specific examples for, you know, of how George Mason University faculty are actually creating research and programs abroad, maybe more specifically than what you've just said. It sounds just tremendously interesting. Stay with us. This is going to be interesting. We'll be right back.
Oh, my.
Dr. Shaklee, this sounds so exciting. I want to jump on a plane and go with you to Russia or somewhere else, you know. But you've talked about how the George Mason University faculty have actually created, they've done some research, and they've developed programs to improve education in other countries, mm-hmm. which is quite different from just having an exchange student.
Oh, absolutely.
Yes. Would you give us some examples of that?
For the last 5 years, we worked in Pakistan. Under the leadership of Jack Levy and Sherry Steele, we have had groups of Pakistani educators first come to us for 3 years. They would stay for 3 months, and they specifically would target things that the country wanted to develop. These are not by our choice, this is by their choice, areas in which they wanted to improve. One of the kinds of things that happens is they oftentimes want to shift from a teacher-directed pedagogy to a student-centered pedagogy. They do believe, and frankly I do agree with him, that even though we do have our problems in American public education, we are still the best system in the world.
Amen.
So they do come to find out about that, and they want to know, what does it mean to be student-centered? And what does it mean to use alternative forms of assessment rather than national examinations? And what does it mean to change the pedagogy in the classroom so there's more discussion and more contact? So for 3 years, they came to us. And then in the fourth year, our faculty went to Islamabad and did the same kind of work with them. We actually ended the project last spring with online video conferencing. And we did that for a semester and used electronic media in order to facilitate the question. And yesterday, we had one of their faculty members with us, and they would now like to send 3 to 5 of their faculty to study with us for master's and PhD. So that connection is long-term, sustainable. We don't do what I'd call drop-in projects. We like to develop, you know, education has a lot of those.
A lot of those.
We like to develop long-term relationships. We like to develop a partnership that will last over time, and I do believe that this is one of those. Another one that we have right now is China. We are working with the Beijing University for Languages and Culture, and Dr. Marjorie Haley is the lead on that project, and we will be bringing 20 teachers of English who are Chinese who will come to study with us again for another year. And the same kind of thing, the same kind of let's transform the higher education system gently, nudging it away from didactic or lecture-oriented and more into active involvement, active engagement at the university level, which we hope will, of course, trickle down to the teaching level of regular classroom teachers and students.
I think this is just amazing. I, in fact, read an article recently about how China and Japan, I think it was mainly Japan, mm-hmm. were looking to the United States for exactly what you talked about when you spoke about Pakistan, mm-hmm. that they want to know more about student-centered teaching. Mm-hmm. And in this country, we hear people saying, we have to have national tests and get and teach them all the same thing so that we can beat out, you know, our test scores will surpass right. the rest of the world. So it's really, what a conundrum. I mean, it's almost paradoxical of what's happening in our country and listening to what you're saying, the international community is saying. But we'll go on here, and I'm mm-hmm. so glad to hear that we are doing this from George Mason University. I noted that George Mason University is the first university in North America and the only university in the United States to receive the International Baccalaureate Organization's recognition for its graduate programs right. in international education. So before I ask you to explain what you call FAST Train, that's mm-hmm. the program, what is the International Baccalaureate Association or organization? So our viewers will know why this is so important.
Most likely they would hear it as IB, not International Baccalaureate. It was a grassroots organization that came out of the 60s that really believed that there were better curriculum models to be used with children, and that there were ways in which we could help children learn that would engender international mindedness. So they set out a means by which they created curriculum, and the diploma programs were first, and those would be high school programs, and we have those throughout the United States. Then they would have the middle years programs, and then now, more recently, they have PYP, which is the primary years program. Mm-hmm. And it is based on principles of learning that we would recognize, like constructivism and like hands-on learning and inquiry-based and problem orientation. But it's also based on children learning to ask essential questions.
Ah.
It's based on children being able to say, this is content and this is important knowledge. It's based on teachers being able to say, these concepts are critical to the child's understanding of particular knowledge or a student's understanding of physics or whatever it is that they're studying at that point in time. They have a very rigorous system of assessments that actually have to be exported and cross-moderated by other faculty across the world.
Really?
So students who graduate from an IB program would be international students. It would make them more mobile and make it easier for them to transfer with their families and things like that. So IB, 2 years ago, decided that they would have a teacher practitioner award program that they have developed, and we applied. So did the University of Bath in England and the University of Melbourne in Australia. And right now we are the 3 universities in the world that can provide graduate programming for teachers
wow.
who teach in IB schools.
Wonderful.
Well, yeah, we're pretty excited
about
it.
You must be very excited
it was a lot
about
of work.
This. Yeah. So now tell us, I really never had such a wonderful explanation of the IB program. I've seen it written, but thank you. I can understand now why it's so special. Now the FAST Train program that you have, which has been recognized by the International Baccalaureate Organization.
FAST Train is actually an acronym. I want to be very clear
oh,
on
yes.
that.
Okay.
It was started as the Foreign Affairs Spouses Teacher Training Program
let's
in
see,
1990.
Let's do that again. The Foreign Affairs
Spouses Teacher Training Program.
Oh, it was for the spouses.
Well, it was. It was an initiative with the Office of Overseas Schools, U.S. Department of State, the Virginia Department of Education and George Mason University with my predecessor, Jack Levy. And they came to us and they said, we have all of these wonderful spouses floating around with the military and floating around with the Foreign Service and floating around with the diplomatic corps. They would love to have something to do. They've got tremendous backgrounds. The international schools really do need highly qualified teachers. Is there a way that we could bridge this gap? And so we created the Fast Train model, which is a hybrid model. They come to us for 5 weeks in the summer, intensive, courses that run from 8 until 4 o'clock every day. They have no time off at all. They would tell you that. And then they do online courses in the fall and the spring. And so the first year, they can receive their license from the state of Virginia, and we do elementary and English language. And then the second year, if they stay, come back to us again, they can have they'll earn a master's degree.
Is that so?
Right.
Isn't that... Now, there is an example of asking the right questions. You said you wanted to teach these young children mm-hmm. to ask the right questions. And what a wonderful question, what to do with the spouses and help them to become more educated.
And we've expanded past that. Now it's any international educator across the world. Oh. So last week I had a class of 18 students, and I believe 4 were from the Philippines, 2 were from China, 1 was from Korea, 1 from Africa, 2 from the Emirates. The class itself is internationalized, and that is a wonderful dynamic, just a wonderful dynamic.
And the language proficiency must be at all different levels.
It
when
is.
People come in.
It is, from time to time.
I mean, you must be an amazing teacher because you're talking to people with all kinds of backgrounds, differences in languages and culture, and I'm sure it must be very exciting for the students as well as they interact.
It is. It's very good connection, mm-hmm. very good networking. It's not surprising when we travel to some of the other conferences for our students to come up to us and say, oh, I was there. I was at Mason such and such a day and year. Right about now, we think we have about 800 graduates all over the world.
Oh, that is so exciting. Well, good luck to you. I hope it continues. Mm-hmm. But, you know, here in America, we're stuck. Oh, I shouldn't put my own opinion on that. We're in the era of high accountability sure. standards and high-stakes testing. People will say, well, you know, you're teaching all this international stuff. How do you evaluate it? How do we know whether it's, really valuable? How do you test it?
Well, it's tested much the same way that our standardized tests and assessments work here in the United States. The schools that are, for instance, IB schools that are here in the United States, they do all of the forms of testing. They'll do what the International Baccalaureate requires, and then they'll do what the state of Virginia requires. Oh. So, for instance, Randolph Elementary School that's up in Arlington is a PYP school, and they are doing wonderfully well on the standardized testing required by No Child Left Behind, and their children are making tremendous progress. Are they teaching to the test? No. Are they embedding as what they should do, and that's my personal opinion. Are they embedding what the questions would be on the test within this broad, rich curriculum based on inquiry and questioning and problem solving? Sure, a smart teacher would do that. But they have gone from not making annual yearly progress to making it. Their scores are going up. So if they're domestically based, they're doing both. Mm-hmm. If they're international schools, they still look toward Western models of assessment. So for their high schoolers will still be taking things like AP exams and the SATs and the ACTs. Or if they're British-oriented, they'll be taking the O-levels and the British examinations. Mm-hmm. So that hasn't really stopped. Mm-hmm. But they haven't given up their faith and their hope in the fact that that broad, rich curriculum will meet the needs of the children and the children will pass the test. And sometimes I think in the United States we've given up that faith.
Mm-hmm. Well, sometimes the faith is shaken by
exactly.
the principal's orientation within the school. In some places they cut out recess.
Oh, I know.
I mean, you've read some of the horror stories about just filling in bubbles, and some places are seeing a larger dropout rate, mm-hmm. For fear. So all of us talk about how that is not the only way to evaluate a child on that
exactly.
one day and that one test, and yet somehow we're still stuck with that, but except for teachers like the ones you're talking about.
Well, they've made the transition. The schools mm-hmm. have made a commitment to internationalize the curriculum. The schools have made a commitment to also attend to the requirements of the state, and they're proving that it can be done. Mm-hmm. So it's not we can't, it's just an orientation.
Again, the orientation and the training and resource mm-hmm. of the teacher.
Exactly.
I mean, perhaps you'd like to say a word or two about that, about the importance in private before we came on the air. You were saying how important the teacher is to all of this, international or national, with tests, with No Child Left Behind or without. Maybe you'd like to say a word about the importance.
Well, I think I did say it before, but I will say it all the time because yes. I do believe it. I think that the teacher is the single most important variable in the classroom, and I'm certainly not the first person who's mm-hmm. said it, but I do believe that his or her orientation, their background, their training, their belief in high-quality curriculum and the process of inquiry with students, it makes the difference every day about what mm-hmm. happens. And so what we can do at Mason to contribute to them feeling secure, feeling knowledgeable, demonstrating their competency in terms of being able to perform on the job using high-quality curriculum like this, all of those things, I think, are our contribution to helping them, you know, retain that professional piece of who they are as a teacher. And they work hard.
Mm. This means a great deal to me because I'm talking with someone who you're doing education around the world. And when you say the teacher is the most important, I hope people are listening because I never feel they're totally respected or remunerated fairly. And I know how hard so many of the teachers work to mm-hmm. meet the needs of children. I wonder if I could get your personal opinion now. What is your greatest disappointment or frustration that you have in developing this international education?
Well, we could always point to funding, but then that would be true of education at large. So, I mean, that's not a surprise. That would not necessarily be a question. I think continuing to get people to understand the value and the importance of internationalizing their curriculum is probably the most important thing that I'd like to see continued.
Thank you. And that sounds like a reason for hope as well, mm-hmm. and not just a frustration. Thank you so much, Dr.
Thank
Beverly
you.
Shaklee. In closing, I'd like to say that international education not only broadens the knowledge and perspective of students and teachers, but I think it holds the promise of global understanding that could lead, hopefully, could lead to resolving conflicts and world peace. I think this is a conversation worth having. I think we should step up our international school talk.